keep my spirit alive. Keep my spirit alive. Alive. Morning.
Say to people that say you turned your back on the culture or
exactly black 100%. People. I have turned my back on the idea of victimization mentality. We are locked up. We went from 1 and 4. We went from 1 and 4 to 1 and 3, but we always pointing at the white people, but yet we want to spend all of our money on foreigns. We want to spend all our money on luxury as opposed to going and buying some land. America is for sale, and there's a lot of barren land. Disney bought a lot of it in Florida. But the culture has you focused so much on fucking somebody, bitch, and pulling up in a foreign and rapping about things that could get you locked up and then saying you about prison reform. Mm. Like, it's, bro, we brainwashed out here, bro. Come on, man. This is a free man talking.
Call Halayim La Yahawa, Bashem Yahushai, Bashem Rakakwadash. Double honors unto the apostles, elders, and bishops of Great Millstone who do rule well. Shabbat Shalom to you of us that are hopeful. Shabbat Shalom to the elect. Let's go to Psalms 83. Psalms, the 83rd chapter. Psalms 83, and we'll start at 2. Verse 2, because it says this. For lo, thine enemies make a tumult. Now, tumult, according to the Hebrew here, means rage, to make war, to be troubled. Why? Because they know that all their power and the high esteem once held for them as a nation by the other nations is fleeting, and their rule over the low and the meek are about to be stripped away. And which nation in particular am I referencing? That would be that of Esau, Edom, so-called white establishment, so you can understand, okay? Another translation is for tumult is commotion. Now, of course, meaning noise. We know the noise referred to here, speaking to the tumult made by the enemies of we Israelites, starting with the elect, is the state of confusion they've attempted on a daily to spread over the masses. Their ideas of democracy, their politics, their many distractions, like so-called black culture, that's one. Their influence over fashion, over the music, the wine of their violence, the many threats against we Israelites they pose if we don't conform and indulge in their poison. The many blasphemies against the Heavenly Father, His Son, and the Rakakwadash, the holy, holy meaning set apart spirit they've spread across the earth. Another word for tumult and commotion is chaos. Their brand of chaos is meant to leave you disorientated and what? Confused. That is when they promise you what? The idea of order and a sense of normalcy, but there's nothing normal about it, okay? What's the new term? Stay dangerous. Well, you gotta stay dangerous when that madman himself, Esau, is at the helm, meaning you gotta expect the unexpected from this guy. Speaking to noise, how about the noise of their vials? Amos 6 and 5 says, they chant to the sound of the vial. Now, we know vial in the scriptures is in reference to music, okay? And invent to themselves instruments of music like David. King David, who we know to be a prophet and a king, was responsible for the book of Psalms. Psalms meaning songs, okay? The knowledge of this truth speaks to already being a song. Our job is knowing the song and staying in tune. When it is taught in its entirety, if you will, and done right, this is the song Yahweh wants to hear. Okay. And people ask me why I fell back from music professionally. Some get it. The most that don't always say, so why don't you come out and drop some jewels of the truth? I think Elder Apostle Gabar said it best. Again, the truth is already a song, and anything else is superfluity. And not only that, but it's excessive. The truth is a song that needs no revision, and it needs no help. Okay. Let me read Amos 6 again. This time I'm gonna start at verse 3. And tell me this doesn't sound like what the hip-hop culture has become since the tumultuous people got involved, okay? Amos 6 at 3, and it says this, "Ye that put far away the evil day," speaking to the two-thirds of Israel, those who aren't looking to be delivered because they're doing too good in this world. They have a high level of fame and well-known in as far as status is concerned. Never mind the fact that they're having too much fun, okay? So they definitely want the party to continue and keep going. Partying and bullshit, blowing money fast, high as a kite, out like a light. Trips to Rio de Janeiro. They're already in their heaven, okay? And cause the seed of violence to come near, meaning they're quick to do wrong, swift to participate in wicked and treacherous acts. Mr. I'll steal your girl, for one. Never mind the murder, death, kill, homicide doctrine of acts of violence and taking part in things that are well averse to the Heavenly Father. Eating groceries. Like, come on, man. Two-thirds of Yahweh's chosen people are literally being led by their burning desires into what we know to be examples worthy of death and destruction. See what they're doing, Puff Daddy now. How many celebrities and are these lesser luminaries have they brought down because of their perversions and the trafficking of flesh, if you will? Okay, Ezekiel 11 and 2 is a great precept. Great precept to the latter part of this verse here, where it says it, and cause the seed of violence to come near. Let me get that, Ezekiel 11 and 2, because it says this. Then said he unto me, son of man, these are the men that devise mischief and give wicked counsel in this city. These so-called jewels you hear in their lyrics. If a nigga catch an attitude, pop it like it's hot. Pop it like it's hot. Right? The city being referenced is America. Okay. Which say it is not near. Let us build houses. The city is the cauldron and we be the flesh. Some of you know exactly what I'm talking about when I say I grew up with the very same people. If there's beef, I'm ready to cook. Them type of Negroes who had zero chill. They ended up being judged by 12 or carried by 6. Only a few truly make it to that next level, and even fewer ever make it out. Okay, back to Amos 6 and 4. And it says this, that lie upon beds of ivory and stretch themselves upon their couches, and eat the lambs out of the flock and the calves out of the midst of the stall, meaning they live in their best life. The Bentley truck is plush and lavish. Okay, they eat the best, they drink the best, they smoke the best, they stroke the best. Nothing, no house, no car, no private jet, no excess is unobtainable. Okay, there is no too great of an expense. Everywhere they go, their face card is good. You want it, they got it. Nothing they do want is out of their reach. Amos 6 and 5 again. That chant to the sound of the viol. There you go. What does that sound like? Chanting to the sound of the music or to the beat of the drum. Now here, chant in the Hebrew means to scatter words, which further proves the point. But another translation is the word prate, which means to talk excessively and pointlessly. In other words, it refers to speaking in a foolish or idle manner. That's the mumble rap niggas especially. And invent to themselves instruments of music like David, meaning they set out to create new songs as if the old ones weren't good enough. Jesus walks. And I've been listening to Kanye, but too bad Jesus ain't the Lord's real name. Okay. They say, pray for me, when we know they've done everything under the sun worthy of judgment according to Yahweh's will. Or this is God's plan, they'll say, when they want nothing to do with what Yahweh Bashem, Yahweh Shai has planned. Okay. And then they got the nerve to justify these little jingles of death with ideas they're just following in the example of the great men of the Lord, like King David and like King Solomon and Hamashiach, Yahweh Shai. Now, I did a podcast interview recently about my experience in the industry, and it reminded me of why I need to stay far away from so-called black culture, okay? Nobody can agree on how to stop the killing. Everybody wants to carry on with the facade of, I'm that nigga, and never will you hear a solution based on acknowledging that which we know is greater than ourselves, okay? Amos 6:6, and that greater than ourselves, I'm talking about Yahweh Bahashem, Yahweh Shai. That never comes into play unless they're thanking the Heavenly Father for gain, but we know that gain is not godliness, okay? Amos 6:6, that drink wine in bowls, meaning drinking in excess, popping bottles, champagne overflowing, and anoint themselves with the chief ointments, which basically speaks to indulging in their luxury, okay? But they are not grieved for the affliction of Joseph, which, like the story of Job, is a metaphor for we Israelites, afflicted, being held captive and separated from not only our lineage and our brothers and like-minded spirit, but from our power and the understanding of this truth, okay? And especially in the sense of the two-thirds today who love Charleston White, who call the men of the Lord everything but children of the God, of God. They blatantly disregard the warning of the prophet still, like what we said about drinking the dumpster juice, i.e. taking a jab, or Jacob's trouble and everything leading up to the MOTB, i.e. denying Yahweh while Yahweh Shai only to become property and under the control of Esau, Edom, like Shalmaneser, who also took Israel captive. Okay, I digress. So let's close this out by going back to Psalms 83. We'll pick up at verse 3. And it says this: they have taken crafty counsel against thy people and consulted against thy hidden ones. Today, speaking to the conspiracy against the nation of we true Hebrew Israelites, we so-called Negroes, Hispanics, and American Indians, and those who may not look like us but are with us in mind and spirit, by you know, that conspiracy first headed off by Esau, Edom, aka the so-called white establishment at the front, so-called white supremacy, their so-called white representatives, and the other nations who stand confederate with them. It is they that help to facilitate the belief and instill in we Israelites that we can't be nothing more than niggers or wiggers or beaners, coons, and spicks. They're just cattle to be branded, if you will, beasts of burden to be exploited. To them, we are mere sources of labor and servitude. This is what is meant by their crafty counsel, okay? To them, we are nothing more than a product to be marketed and merchandised, if you will. On top of that, we are their favorite source of entertainment. Let me not leave that out. They love to see us compromise our integrity for the carrots they dangle in front of our face. They love to see us crash out over the confusion they themselves have caused. Why? Because they know good and goddamn well who we really are. We stay hidden because to them, every other nation is more worthy, and we ain't sophisticated enough to be the true children of the Most High Power. But being hidden is twofold. It was the Heavenly Father, whose true name is Yahweh, not God, that hid us in order to preserve us in these end times, okay? We are hidden from the world who don't have eyes to see or ears to hear, that we are the Most High's heritage and apple of His eye. Right, they'll tell you it doesn't matter what the Lord or Yahweh Shai, not Jesus, looks like, because instinctively that severs any idea of being related or connected to the Heavenly Father and His Son, the only one worthy enough to save. And I'm speaking to the coming in the stead of the original Hebrew Israelites, the so-called Negroes, Latinos, and American Indians, those who are labeled black or brown today, okay? Lamentations 1:21 says, they are glad that thou hast done it, meaning they are all glad they brought us down to a low estate, okay? Psalms 83:4, they have said, come and let us cut them off from being a nation, that the name of Israel may be no more in remembrance. Ergo, the other nations made a collective agreement to destroy we Israelites and to remove us from our heritage. That's the point of that verse there. This is why they push us to take drugs, promote the mindset of fixing our disagreements with violence, why they market obesity and advertise overeating, GMO and abominable foods. You may think sound mind and body is something they just say in it because it sounds good and it doesn't matter, but it does. Think about the peril and the dis-ease it can cause. It's also why they push adultery and promote the masculinizing of our women and why they set out to make little so-called black boys effeminate and then call anything a testosterone-filled toxic masculinity. All right? Why they use promises of wealth and success to compromise us and to pacify us. Why they preach to us about the great sense of pride one should have in being self-made, well-off and wanting for nothing instead of being humble. And the people of faith trusting in the Most High to deliver. Never will they promote that. You got to take your destiny into your hands, own hands, is what they say. Scripture says it is a fearful thing to fall in the hands of the living power. Hebrews 10 and 31. Now, I don't agree with everything Ye said, but I do share in some of his sentiment. Okay, America is not for sale, only because it's a company that's privately owned. Okay, you only think it's gone public. Matter of fact, America is a private corporation. The finger gets pointed at so-called white people because the political designation of white was invented in 1681 to give Esau Edom privilege and a legalized advantage over so-called people of color. Okay, America's a family business made of shares that most of we Israelites have to work seven times as hard to even look at. Everybody else in Babylon, the great, aka America, are really just workers. Okay. Only those who are down with the agenda in whatever way are allowed to get in on the ground level. And even then, they got to run in circles before they work their way up. But what they won't and don't tell you is they themselves never cross the threshold. The ones they do let through the gate, their job is to popularize niggerism, meaning they make it cool to act depraved and indifferent to wickedness. If you've been shot or shot at, killed somebody, stabbed up, or you never did a bid, then, or you ever did a bid, Salakia, then you're a real nigga, according to their standards. If you ain't slung cracks, pushed coke, or scammed the system, if you don't fly first class, if you don't drive a Benz, if you don't own $10,000 chosen heart jeans, if you don't have on an AP when you talk about building your own, you ain't a real boss. That's what they say. And this is that false sense of pride that the scriptures talk about, that Yahweh hates, that lack of humility. And what really speaks to disobedience is the disconnect from our power, Yahweh Shai. Okay, this is what they set out to do, to separate Israel from remembrance of who our true power is. And this is why the technocrats, the international bankers, the elite globalists, if you will, are pushing AI and pushing human enhancement via robotics and technology. This is why they're prepping you for another scamdemic so that you blindly accept the next dose of that secret sauce. The idea is to alter our DNA in real time and with the hope they can subvert our mind, right? They don't want you to think independently from the system. They want you to obey, serve, and then obey. They know turning you into iPhone 18 will sever the connection we so-called Negroes, Latinos, Natives, and those scattered have to the Most High via the pineal gland, with what the world over calls your third eye. Okay, so we can't receive that light of salvation from the spirit of Yahweh Bashem, Yahweh Shai. In keeping with the High Holy Day, let's get this. Let's make some righteous noise to the naysayers at least, and then maybe we'll get one more and close out. Okay, let's go to Joel 2:1. Let's go there, because it says this: "Blow ye the trumpet in Zion, and sound an alarm in my holy mountain." Speaking to we Israelites, we so-called blacks and browns, and those who don't look like us per se, but share with us the same fear of the Heavenly Father and the same hope of salvation and deliverance in mind and in spirit. Okay, "Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord power Yahweh cometh, for it is nigh at hand." Nigh at hand meaning it's very close. So y'all see it. The writing is on the wall, especially America. Day by day you see this devil system thoroughly crashing down. And this is what we're doing now, blowing the trumpet. Okay, we're making that sound of that sounding the trumpet and sounding that alarm. Sounding the alarm is prophesying aloud. Prophesying meaning to say before. The scriptures tell us we men of the Lord to cry aloud and spare not, meaning we give a rat's ass about your feelings. We don't care if you can't handle the truth buying land, supporting so-called black culture and generational wealth, and having a Kardashian-sized bomb shelter is not going to save you from the great tribulation and terrible day of the Lord if you don't repent and come back onto the Lord, okay? The only thing money, power, and respect is going to get you in this world is a thermonuclear missile. Take that. John 8:32, for those of you in the circumference of my voice and on road or at home, you can get that scripture yourself. The free man you're talking to is me. And none of us are free from sin, from death, or the enemy until Yahweh Bashem, Yahweh Shah, returns.